There we are, everybody, our little lioness. We've moved round. Her eyes are open. She might look like she's looking at us, but, well, in theory, all she should see is a couple of fairly dim red glows. She is in infrared, and as far as I know, we're in black and white there. There, one of the males calling. She's going to call now. Let's see. One of the males was just calling. There we go. Interesting that she's doing most of the calling. Responding, but not the one here. It's interesting. One here is just lying there, wondering where his tail went. See? Can't quite figure out why it is that she feels like half a lion. Now, just to give you an idea, with my sort of naked eye, as it were, I can sort of make them out. Chandra, of course, has got a bright white light blinding me completely, but when I shield that from myself, I can just sort of make them out. These infrared lights are really quite special. And the thermal one is also pretty cool. And just in case you're wondering if there are leopards here, yes, we do see leopards here. We saw one leopard so far. We saw his back end sitting in a tree. He killed a wildebeest calf, I think. Oh, she's quite tired, but this, of course, as you know, is often a precursor to them getting up and moving or licking their feet. Those claws that unfortunately were used to destroy the life of a little wildebeest calf today, but everything has to eat. I think we should make a little turn around them, don't you, Chandra? We'll get her face, unless we just, let's wait here for a little while. We're not going to see anything coming down the road. I'm going to ask Graham to perhaps stick the flare down the road to see if there isn't another male coming yet, but it doesn't seem there is. There is the flare monitor looking eerily Blair Witch style down the road. Oh, and there is the lioness, like an Egyptian god. Pale white upon the termite mound. Isn't that cool? That's called infrared and thermal imaging. That's what we do here. That's how we roll at Wild Earth. That's me in infrared, Chandra. That's dangerous. Don't do that to me again. That's so cool. Now, it's pitch black dark now here in Vamara. I think you've still got a bit of light left in South Africa, which is quite cool. And we're into now the second drive in a row, as it were. And I must just tell you that while we look at these sleeping kitties, this is the first time I've ever heard myself present a full show. I can hear my own voice talking to myself exactly 1/2 second after I say what I say. It's very disconcerting, and my brain may explode before 11 o'clock tonight. Chandra, we heard that. Was that your belly? Yeah. The other bad news, of course, is that we don't have our packed suppers with us, which means we're going to be very cranky at the end of this. Yes? Oh, there seems to be some heat there on the floor, everybody. I wonder if that ain't a herd of beefalo. Look at that. Seem to be herd of buffalo heading this way. All right, while we try and figure out what exactly those white spots are in the background, Jamie Patterson is back with the 8 little Nkahuma cubbies. Link. Now we've moved slightly, everybody. This is the second male now. Got up and come across here, probably to see what's going on. He's exhausted after his walk of 150 meters. It's approximately 400 feet. He seems to be missing an ear, is he? Oh, I wonder. Maybe he's just got a scraggly, I've just got up haircut. But they are in prime conditions, these male lions. Well, they're not youngsters. You might be able to see they're just a bit fuller up. They're a bit fuller, I mean a bit filled out compared with the Birminghams. And it's now completely dark outside. And what we'll do at some stage, not right now, is just show you exactly how dark it is by turning off the IR. He is now grazing. This is because he feels like he might be a wildebeest. No, he's decided I'm not a wildebeest after all. But I do have a slightly sore tummy after all the wildebeest I've been eating. Now the reason there are so many hundreds and thousands of different animals living on these plains is because of many of the grasses that you're looking at now that this lion is luxuriating in. And it's called Themida triandra, or red grass. Here they call it red oat grass, which is a rather more romantic name, I feel. And it just supports an incredible array of animals because the soil beneath it is so much more fertile than it is in southern Africa. And that's because in southern Africa you've got those big woodlands, and those woodlands are supported by soils that are far less fertile than the ones here. And that's because the ones in South Africa are much more ancient than the ones up here. There's relatively, well, in fact, very distant volcanic activity in this area, but much more recent than it was in southern Africa. And so that's why these great plains contain so many nutrients that are able to sustain this immense sward of red grass, and in turn the herbivores that come and eat on it year in and year out. I think the other interesting thing about the system, while we watch this lion just licking his feet, is that it really is an area of, probably completely wilderness. You know, there's no human interference at all. Well, there's no pumping of water, bar for one little pond that I saw that I think is more a borrow pit than it is pumped water. And also, crucially, there's one sort of management regime of the land. Huge areas of land get burned every year, and then they get rested. But because there's only one kind of landowner, it all gets treated in the same way. And I think that's a tremendously effective way to run a piece of wildlife land. Very nice. Just remember, we're as live as everyone else is, and we're going to be live. If you're surprised as to why we're still live, this is the safari marathon, if you like. We're going to be live for 7.5 hours, which means we do need to keep talking to you. Please hashtag safari live, questions at wildearth.tv. And I know perhaps many of our British viewers are getting home from work or arriving home and thinking about cooking some fish and chips or mushy peas or some bangers, perhaps even. He is missing that ear, you know that. There we are. Is he? I think it's earless. Earless, pom-pomless, and a couple of others. They do have proper names if this is the male coalition we think they are, and I'll get to that a little bit later. So back to the British guests or British viewers. If you are watching, please, would be great to have some questions from you, of course, because this is now your time of having supper. While you think about what you're going to have, let's head across to Jamie, who has got still the Nkuhuma cubs in the last of the Southern African sunbite. Now, that's just a brief shot, everybody, of what you're looking at there. It's one lion in the foreground and a herd of beefaloes coming this way from the other side. Now, this, of course, is why we came here. Let's go down to the IR view of the actual lion. That's me. Hello. The lion is over there. And there he is, over the top of the snorkel. And we're here, of course, to try and see if we can follow a lion hunt at night, and you can see that there is clear space between the buffalo and the lion. But these lions have been roaring, and so their enthusiasm for hunting, well, it must be called into question. But let's see what happens. This is a great opportunity to see if the lions of the Mara are going to hunt the buffalo across these plains. It would be quite something to see. We thought for a second they might be gnus, but no, they're not. They're definitely buffalo. They're too big. Sitting next to me, you may have seen, there is Simon. And Simon is the head warden at the Ulololo Gate, which is the major... Oh, this is exciting. I'll tell you a bit more about Simon later. Taylor has got the spotted prince of cats.
We just keep missing him, everybody. He's disappearing into the darkness, as you can see. I haven't switched to infrared just yet, everybody, just because it's proving difficult to try and keep up with him, and I really need to be able to see where I'm going. Let's try and get him again. He's playing cat and mouse this evening, but I'm so excited because it's the first time I'm able to see Tingana. And I know Jamie had such a special sighting of him the other day. Now, he's very vocal. He just called again, so hopefully we're going to be able to catch him calling for us, because it's quite a beautiful sound. It's not quite like a lion roar. There he is on the road again, and I just need to tell Aubrey that we've got him. Aubrey, we're still on shortcut, Galago shortcut. His little mobile east, there's one unlock, Makulu Madoda Ingwe, one making the approach. He's going to mark over here, can you see that? See how he's spraying his urine up against this tree. Listen, listen. Can you all hear that? Now, this is Karula's territory, everybody. So I wonder if he's perhaps looking for her, or he could also be doing a territorial patrol with him marking his territory like that. He's maybe just indicating to everybody that, oh, let me get out of four-wheel drive, otherwise we're not going to be able to go anywhere. Maybe he's just indicating to the other male leopards that this area is occupied. This is quite exciting. I'm going to be doing a lot of turning around and trying to focus on where I'm going. Oh no, please don't go into the thick bushes, Tingana. Until he settles down, I think we're going to stay with just a spotlight. And when he becomes a little more static, then we'll try and switch to IR. It's just very thick vegetation through here, everybody. But isn't he beautiful? He's a big leopard. And I believe he's about 9 years old, and he doesn't even have a neck anymore. He's just got a dewlap. Can you see that? Look when he turns to the side there. Now, that's an indication that he is well mature. Fantastic genetics. We're going to try and keep up with him. Modora Ingwe is still mobile along a shortcut, Galago shortcut. He's mobile in an easterly direction. I presume he's going to head to the Mati, to Puza. There's one unlock, one standing by, or I think two mobiles now standing by at the Mati.
The lion has got up, everyone. He made a big roaring noise, of course. And then we thought, well, he's obviously not going to try and kill a buffalo if he's shouting at them. and he's managed to get up, and he's now walking towards the others. So let's see what happens here. We might see all three brothers together, which will be very exciting. He seems to be marking his territory there. I'll just switch off here a second. He's walking straight towards them. He's just going over this little dry drainage line area. I think we're still alive. I seem to have lost the final control. DeAndre, you still got them?
Nope.
We may or may not be live. Oh, we still have us. That's excellent. Good stuff. Oops. Oh, just dropped my Skype call. This area is a disaster for signal. And rate the quality of the call, it wants to know. 1 out of 5 it's going to get for that one. Alright, so we're just going to see what he does. If he goes flat with the others, we might consider going towards the herd of buffalo, because behind that herd of buffalo, apparently today, the rest of the lions were. So that would be interesting. And there were, well, there was a rumour of another male with them, a young male apparently. But that is just hearsay. Move a little bit closer. I have to turn the lights on a bit, otherwise I can't see anything, and we'll drive into the riverbed and I will be in immeasurable amounts of trouble. See what we can get here. I'm going to try and figure out why. Right, I'm not sure. We're trying to get hold of the final control. We've lost them for now. That's okay. We'll figure it out as we go along. We'll just let him get a little bit used to us, and then we'll move up next to him and see if we can't get all three of them in one shot. Ah. Right, let me just do this quickly. We're just going to keep watching everybody.
Sorry about that, everybody. James's communication disappeared. Dave and I have just had one of the most intense experiences, certainly the most intense experience of...
Now, we've left the lions, everyone. They're fast asleep, but they can sense something's up, possibly just the fact that we've come after them, and we're now sitting here in the pitch-black darkness, shining a very dim red glow on them. And this is one of the great joys of what we're doing out here, of course, is that we can view animals we don't normally see in the night, during the night. And that means we can assess what their behavior is at this time of the day, because normally we wouldn't be looking at them. I suspect on a warm night like this, these buffalo will probably feed a bit, and then as it gets towards the late night, they'll probably lie down and chew the cud. They would have heard those lions. We're not far from them now. Probably only about, about a kilometer or so, no less, probably about 400 meters, a quarter of a mile from where those where the lions are. But they were roaring, and so whether they'll try and hunt the buffalo or not, I don't know. I'm pretty sure they know the buffalo are here. They would have heard them grunting and groaning as they've walked along. But we'll wait and see what happens. What we were rather hoping to do is head down the road here and see if we couldn't find the rest of this pride, the Kichwa pride, and introduce ourselves to the other five lionesses. John, I think you're going to have to kill that light because of the quite astonishing number of insecta there. Jose, I don't know. I think that's quite an interesting question you're asking there. I think, if I heard your question correctly, you're trying to find out if the animals are able to see in infrared at all, and perhaps they can see, perhaps we're assisting them. with their view of the world. I think it's possible. I don't know that they... I think some animals see in a form of infrared. Infrared, of course, is a lower wavelength than we're able to see. And I think some animals could certainly see it, especially those perhaps that have to see at night. But I don't think it'll look anything like the picture you're looking at now, which is quite astonishing given how pitch black dark it is outside. The moon apparently will come up at around 9 o'clock local time. That's 8 o'clock Central African time. So that'll be quite interesting to see. I'm not sure, looking above me here, there are some stars, a smattering, but it's quite a cloudy night. So we'll sit with these beefies for a little while, and then we'll make our way down the road and see if we can't find those other lionesses, because it would be just very special to see the whole pride and introduce ourselves to them so that they all know what you look like and what you sound like, and me too. And they know what Gendre's socks smell like. Now, I think I may have made a mistake. I told Gendre to turn off the presenter light because it was attracting insects. But now, of course, the monitors inside the screen are attracting every fly this side. Oh, listen. Listen. See the buffalo, not particularly worried about it, but they're definitely aware of exactly where that sound's coming from. So they all turn to face, obviously decided they're not close enough to be of too much worry, and they've got on with it. They may well lie down here. They haven't moved very far since we first spotted them with the flare. Maybe, Gendre, shall we try another flare shot? I would hold it up for you. There is my head, everybody. Look at what they look like. Isn't that amazing? That is so cool. You see that, Gendre? One of them has just relieved itself. And its dung is still warm. That's an astonishing thing to behold. It's quite a good way of tracking, I suppose. You can tell how fresh some dung is. Now that buffalo looking at us, I think, is looking at the sound of my voice. There I am, everybody. I don't think it's... Oh, it probably could smell us too, obviously. But I don't think it's looking at us. It's so cool. Chewing the cud. Herds of buffalo here compared with the Sabi San, I thought had been quite similar, you know. We don't see many of them in the Sabi San, but when we do, they're sort of 150 to 200 strong, and that's been roughly the same as here. Yeah, smelling now. You just see the nose lifting. Gendre, what about the other side of the car? I think there's one there. I heard some...
Which side, sorry, James?
Sorry, to the left. Let's just see how far the extent of this car, this herd goes. There we are. There they are. A good size herd this year. I'd say about 250 belching animals, and they're staring at us now. Not particularly sure of what they're looking at. They can smell diesel. Like I say, Gendre's socks. One of the members of the back of the vehicle making a slight belch there, and I'm sure they can sense that, wondering what it is. Maybe they think there's a buffalo in the back of this car. But not affected. They're quite interested. You can see carrying on with the business of chewing the cud. Not in the least bit worried, which is exactly what we want out here. Cool. So if you have just joined us, everyone, we have extended the drive, of course, for an extra four and a half hours. Quite a nice extension to our normal drive. And that is, of course, to explore the night creatures that are going on in the Sabi Sands in South Africa and, of course, here in the Mara Triangle. And what we're hoping for over the course of the next 5 nights is to be able to follow the lions on the hunt. And it's a unique opportunity here because you can basically drive over an immense area. And we also know, of course, that it's clear, it's open. It's not the woodland of the Sabi Sand. And while the Nkuhumas have killed 3 times, I believe, in the last few nights, and you may well get an Nkuhuma kill while we're watching these shows, we're hoping that we're going to get a Kenyan kill over here in the Mara Triangle. It will be very special indeed. Especially if the wildebeest come back. We've had rain for the last 3 nights. We think they could well come wandering back here. That one's just having a sniff at the air. Wet nose, obviously in fine health. Hello, Janet. I think I heard your question correctly. Unfortunately, someone in the final control seemed to be headbutting the wall while the question was being asked. I think your question was, do I think that animals sense differently at night from during the day? Well, oh, here we go. Oh, am I not a bit afraid of being next to the animals in the dark because they may scent us differently in the darkness? No, I'm no more afraid because I think they're very used to us. It's an interesting one though, you know, if we were in a completely open vehicle next to lions we didn't know at all, would I be a little bit nervous? Maybe for a little while, but we know those lions in the Sabi Sand, we can sit next to them all night long, and we have done often with the lights off. They don't treat us any differently from the way they treat us now. And so, no, I'm not nervous at all. Do I think they scent us differently? Yes, probably slightly, but in the same way that you at night, when you wake up in the dead of the night and you perhaps need to go and get a snack from the kitchen, you use your ears and your sense of touch and your sense of smell to get you to the kitchen rather than your eyes. And I think it's the same very much for these animals here. Ooh, Taylor's got a very interesting little primate to show you.
Jamie here, not James, I'm afraid to say. But we do have a lion. Might not be a Mara Triangle lion, but there's definitely a lion. We have let the Nkuhumas and their cubs wander off after our incredible experience with them all around the vehicle. And for now, we have returned to our Birmingham boy, who is still lying up quite comfortably in the middle of the road and showing no inclination that he is going to go wandering off. So Mike is here with some guests, so we're just going to speak quite quietly. And that's the light that you are seeing, because it is...
Like I said, there, as you can see perhaps in that... Well, look, it's not the best picture you've ever seen, but we have something quite interesting there, and we're going to go and drive off road and see if we can't find what it is. Are you ready? That's Jandre pointing out what it is we were looking at. Right, on we go. Now, Graham, we're going to try and get off road here. This might result in us being stuck for 7 days, but we'll try it anyway. Are we still going towards it, Graham? Isn't it difficult to tell? We're going straight towards it now, everybody. Now, it could be something as exciting as an aardwolf, a striped hyena, a spotted hyena. It could also be a hot rock. Perhaps even a very large piece of warm dung. It will be fascinating to know when we get there. Can you see it? Simon says he can see eyes. That's encouraging. Hello, everyone. Excuse my not looking at you. I do not wish to singe my eyeballs with the IR. IR is off. Hi, everybody. Can you see their son? We're getting closer. Oh, I can see eyes. Oh. We've seen one of those before, haven't we, Jandre? There you are, everybody. It's your first Mara Impala. Yes. Well done, everybody. Again. Let's go back to the road and we'll carry on this adventure. This is an excellent way to spot things at night. I'm thoroughly impressed with the thermal camera. Thoroughly impressed with the infrared. Thoroughly impressed, frankly, with being in Kenya. I haven't seen Merrill or Robert just yet. Right, now, we've got very special permission to be off-road. There isn't a lot of off-road driving here, and that's because it's much the same as in the Kruger National Park. In the Kruger National Park, of course, it is a national park. And if you had everybody driving off-road willy-nilly, well, there'd probably be quite a lot of environmental damage. Do you think this is not a good sign? You think we must go to the right? Ow, I've just broken my elbow on one of the sharp points that the Land Rover designers have very kindly put in here. We'll try and get back onto the road. What do you think, Simon? You think we'll make it? You think we'll get stuck for 7 weeks? Simon is in agreement that we'll be stuck for 7 weeks. There we go. So what we're going to do is continue driving along this road, see if we can't find the other five lionesses. Perhaps they are in the process of hunting, and we might be very lucky. Oh, there goes my water bottle. There's the top of my head. Thank you, Jandre. Very flattering angle. So, we don't have a roofless car, everybody, for the same reason that most people don't have open cars because, of course, this is a national park and you can drive your own car. Jamie apparently has some lions. That is going to be much better than watching me contort myself to look at you. Let's go and have a look at them. Now look at that. There are some zebras. That is the IR light, and you may have just seen a little red square flash away from the left-hand side. There we go. It seems to be when this thing thinks it's spotted something else. Then it puts a little red square on it, which is very National Geographic of it, rather than really, isn't it? It's amazing. Look at that. Now these zebras are grazing completely contentedly next to us, probably, about 30 meters or so. And you can see that they are most certainly mammals. They're very hot. 37 or 8 degrees or so. That's so cool. Isn't that amazing? Now, just to explain a little bit about this, of course, it's a thermal imaging camera, which means it's picking up different kinds of temperatures or different temperature variations, and then sort of converting them to the picture that you see there. And the reason that it isn't in the sort of glorious high definition that we normally get is apparently you need to be part of the military to have a very particular fancy one, because I think they're used for nefarious purposes. But this one is good enough for us to see that zebra way behind there on the right-hand side, she's pregnant. And there are lots of pregnant zebra around here at the moment. Look how fat her belly is. The one that just had a flash over her. Let's go back to the IR Gendry and see if we can't get a bit, slightly better view of them. There they are over there. That's it. We're a little bit far from the IR to work particularly well, But there you can see them grazing contentedly, completely free of us. Now look how many there are. When I got here, well, for the first time 2 weeks ago, and then again now, 4 days ago, just astounding the number. This must be a herd of some, I don't know, 100 or 200 zebras. In the background, a hyena is calling. There is a hyena den somewhere around here, but we've yet to be able to find it. Masses and masses of hyena research has been completed in this part of the world. And that's because I think it's just quite easy to sort of drive around here and find them, and you've got this great expanse of land with clans of hyenas, apparently up to 50 strong in some cases. That's so wonderful. Look, she's definitely pregnant too. Look how fat her belly is. Now they move, of course, with the wildebeest, the zebra do, and there are something like 300,000 of them that follow the 1.4 odd million wildebeest that move here. 300,000 zebra. Now that might sound like a lot, of course, but at the end of the day, if you compare it with a human population, it's less than a small city would have. This is the Grant's gazelle, as I said. Not gazelle. It's not a gazelle at all, is it, Jandre? No, it is an equid. Jandre is not talking to me anymore. That's very sad. I wonder what I've done. It's a Grant's zebra. So same as the plain zebra we get back at Juma. Just a slightly different subspecies. And I think that the most distinctive look on the zebra is... Listen, there's a jackal calling. Side-striped jackal. It's a very amazing call. I've never heard them do that. I wouldn't have known what it was if Simon hadn't told me. And obviously no threat to the Roman-nosed Grant's zebra. What I've been trying to tell you. I've tried to tell it to you twice now. There they are. Just a slightly rounded nose there. And no shadow stripe at all. They're just as bad tempered though as the zebras back home. Lots and lots of pregnant females. And look, I mean, they're supposed to have exactly the same sort of structure, social structure, and it's very clear to see when you go to Juma, and you've got a very clear stallion, his wives, one or two offspring, and that's how they move along in what we call a kinship group. This, much more difficult to tell, of course, because they move as a great big group of 200 or 300 quite often. Hello, Monique, you're in London. And you're wondering about the hyenas that we get here and whether we get different kinds of hyenas. There are different kinds of hyena here, Monique. The striped hyena would be a really impressive one to see. It's slightly smaller than the spotted and is ostensibly, I think it is a scavenger of sorts, but it doesn't, it's certainly nothing like as dominant or anything like the size of a spotted hyena. Then the most exciting one that you can find here is something called an art wolf. Now, in theory, you can find them in South Africa. They're not common, but apparently they're a bit more common around here. An art wolf is like a tiny little hyena, and they eat termites and ants. That's what they survive on, almost exclusively on termites and ants. And I'll try and show you a picture, but I don't think it's possible with the infrared. Very nice. Ooh, that's an injury. Now, we did see one zebra today who had a nasty gash on his bottom, very clearly from a lion's claw that slashed at him. But that one seems to be fine. I thought there might be an injury on the neck there. And you can see them grazing, grazing, grazing away. There's so much for them to eat here. And apparently, La Niña has got a slightly different effect, or a completely opposite effect here. So La Niña will make the air dry here, where it is wet and down in South Africa, and El Niño will make it wet here and dry in South Africa. So the grass here is extremely long, and apparently they've had the best wildebeest migration they've had in years this year. Now, I don't know when it was appropriate for me to tell you this, but today, of course, for many of you, you will know, is International Talk Like a Pirate Day. I am not joking in the slightest. It is indeed International Talk Like a Pirate Day, and so I'm going to ask that Rebecca tells Jamie and Taylor to greet you like a pirate the next time you go and see her. As far as I'm concerned, well, I will greet you in my best pirate the next time I see you. We're going to move along down the road, and while we're doing that, let's head across to Captain Jamie on the good ship Rostbucket. Heading off-road to have a look at them. That's a youngster there, and I so miss my hyenas. And we'll just try and follow them. Lovely and open here, so that should be quite easy for us. Shouldn't be too much bouncing. Andre, I'm afraid you're going to have to stay zoomed in on them because I cannot see where they have gone.
It's 11.
11 o'clock?
Yeah. 11 again?
Because Andre, of course, is in two minds, everyone, because if he does zoom all the way in, the picture will shake horribly. All right, let's just keep going. We'll put on a bit of wine.
11 again? Down.
Ah, there they are. Sloping through the night. Now, maybe they'll take us towards their den. Hello, Rain. You're 16 years old, and you say that a bunch of you and your mates are watching this at school on your lunch break. That is awesome. It's really, really good to hear from you, and I'm so glad you're enjoying it. I'm just going to assume that you're in the States. If you're having your lunch break now and you're watching this at school, that's so great. Thanks very much. Tell us what your mates are called. Ask us a question. We'll be more than happy to talk to you. Thank you very much for giving us of your time during your lunch break to watch us. That's fantastic news. Exactly why we do this, everyone. Now, who knows what these hyenas are going to do? Maybe they'll go back towards the den site.
11, John.
There is apparently a den site somewhere around this area. Is that another road there? Now, of course, I'm exploring many of these areas for the first time, the same way that you are, everyone. So, Jason, you're wondering about their calls and whether they act differently in the nighttime. Well, I mean, I've never seen a Mara hyena. Well, I have once, but they seem to behave in much the same way that ours do. But in many parts of East Africa, you know, they hunt even more than the lions do, and probably especially down when they're calving. Around here, however, there's so much to scavenge that I suspect they're largely scavenging. Now, we're driving on. They're walking on a path. I don't know if you're able to make that out, but they're basically driving on a well-worn path, and I wonder if this doesn't lead to their den site. If it doesn't, it will probably be some kind of an elephant path. So let's keep following them. This is just fantastic. Now, we don't often follow hyena off-road at Juma, and that is largely because they don't tolerate the vehicles being mobile and crashing through the bushes behind them, as many of the other cats do. But these chaps, because we're able to drive through some open areas, perhaps they're just going to let us keep following them. Also, so many people have done a huge amount of research on the hyenas of this area that it might be that they'll just put up with us. Look at them going there. Every time I see a little termite mound, I think maybe. Fantastic. This is exactly why we wanted to come out here. Well, essentially we want to see lions hunt, but this is pretty good. We'll go back to those lions just now. We'll let them digest a bit of their food. Hello, Susan in the Netherlands. You want to know if there are big termite mounds here. like there are in South Africa. There aren't, no. There are low ones. There are no doubt just as many termites, but Macrotermes natalensis, which is the big fungus-growing termite that makes all those great big castles of clay at Juma, they don't occur here as far as I'm aware. And also, termites are not hugely huge fans of what we call black cotton soils. I'm just going to stop here in case it's us that's making them run. And these are largely black cotton soils, which means they don't produce the same kind of soil, sandy soils on the ridge crests, that the soils, the granitic soils up at Juma do. I think they've found something, or maybe they thought they had. Now, I cannot see them at all with my naked eye. It's quite interesting. Only Jandre has got sight of them, and you, of course. Are they there? To the left. There they are. They're searching for something, you know. Let's see what they're going to find. Maybe just around this next corner. And of course, hyenas, wonderful animals to be telling stories about once you get to know them, because they are so very individual, and the clan hierarchies are so fascinating to watch as they unfold. I think these are youngsters with one big female. I think she is in front of them. There they're jogging away. I'm going to keep my distance. I'm not going to try and catch up with him. All right, while they go around that bush, we'll see if we can keep up to them. Let's head across to the Birmingham Boys with Jamie Patterson. Look at that, isn't that amazing? That is so cool. Right in front of us now as well, Jandre, maybe. Let's go infrared to them. Just right there. There we go. That's another one there. I'm just going to swing the car slightly, or you just keep following, Jandre. Shall I move around slightly? Yeah, we're going to have to. Let's go there. Now, if you're wondering why there is such a clearing here, you might be thinking, gosh, Cheetah Plains has got larger than when I was last here. But you'd be wrong, everyone. This is the Mara Triangle, the spectacular piece of land up here in Kenya, southern Kenya, and part of the great Mara Serengeti ecosystem. This little chap's coming right past the front now. I think we're quite close to the den. There's obviously, you can see the pseudo penis stuck out there. There's been some kind of social interaction. Cannot be comfortable walking through the grass like that, but hey, there's a couple of animals that do it. Here comes a much bigger one. In fact, they're coming to investigate us. This is wonderful. Just make one out in the darkness here to the right, and another one coming in from there. Oh, there are lots. Good evening. Little one, that's quite close, everyone. That's probably only about, 3 meters, 9 feet. I think they caught sight of one of Jandre's dreadlocks. I'm a little bit nervous. This is wonderful stuff. There we can see the thermal imaging camera. Let me just lift that up for you, you'll see it a bit better. Hear one way in the distance across the river going whoop. Gosh, this is fun, isn't it? Go out with this kind of equipment. And all those little white dots are bits of this incredible diversity that occur here. All of those little white dots. Just going across to the left now to see. Ooh, I think that's an elephant. Is it? And there are three of them right in front of us. Let's go back to the IR. There they go. So we must be close to the den. I don't look, finding it in this light is going to be very difficult, but I think we must be very close by. Brilliant stuff. And that long loping gait, of course, they're designed precisely in the same way that a wildebeest is, so that they can run relatively slowly for a very long time. Hello, P. Hart. You have an interesting question about hyenas. For those of you who don't know, the spotted hyena has is almost hermaphroditic. They have female parts, and they have also they have what was known as a. Gosh, I'm bashing my head here. They have hello, everyone. They have what's known as false female, false male genitalia. And the clitoris is an enlarged pseudopenis. And P. Hart, you want to know basically what function that serves, and are they able to, or do they have to urinate out of it? The answer is yes. There we got a chicken bone. Is that a chicken bone there? It's obviously not a chicken bone, everybody. It's a joint of some kind of meat. That's very nice for that young hyena. While he eats there. P. Hart, yes, they urinate out of it. The urethra is closed, basically. And they also give birth out of it. And it almost always, especially for a first birth, is extremely painful for a hyena and can, in fact, especially in a young hyena, can cause death. So it's quite an interesting discussion which we'll get into when perhaps we've got a bit more light. The evolutionary adaptation for why they should have that and why the social or the advantage of having such dangerous birth outweighed the disadvantage of the advantage of having that strange genitalia outweighed the disadvantage of the dangerous birth. Right, well, let's see what else Graham can find us. Graham, where are you pointing? Looks like some elephants up ahead. Right, before I drive over this very large mountain, which Graham has spotted with the thermal imaging camera, let's head across to Jamie and the nincompoops.
So while James attempts to navigate his mountain...
Look at it there, it is going into a muddy gully through which we cannot follow it, I'm afraid. It's a little nervous of us, and so we're having to keep our distance. Isn't this amazing? This is what hippos do during the night, you see. They sometimes roll in the mud. They eat a lot of delicious red oat grass. And they clearly seem, either this one is offensive and hasn't got any friends, or they like to be alone. They are very blubberous, though. See them waddling there, a huge amount of fat. I'm going to try and go a little bit closer to the edge of the gully there. John, I can't see it now. There it goes, disappearing into the night. I'm afraid I think that's going to be the end of our hippo sighting. We'll see what else Mr. Wallington and his thermal imaging camera can find us. We went back to a road. And Graham then found some shining things, and those shining things turned out to be dung. I'm trying to find the road again. Of course, this is the problem with being completely unfamiliar with an area. Now, the fact that you've got a shongololo out of Juma tells me that the rain must have been wonderful. I'm sure it comes as a great relief to all, especially David, who predicted it correctly. and he got it right for Mara as well. We had a storm on exactly the same time that you did over there in Juma. Which is fantastic. Right, we're going back towards the road, and then we're going to head back towards those lions and see what they're up to. We couldn't find the rest of the pride. Right, and while we're going to find our lions, let's head back to the slightly more familiar ones of Juma with Jamie. Just behind the snorkel, a little hyena is coming across. Hello. Young hyena. What do you think it's smelling, Jean-André?
Possibly your princess break.
Hello. Yes, good day. Now, I know you can't see this everyone, but the hyena is now staring me in the eyes. And hyenas, of course, become quite bold at the night time. And now I'm doing what young hyenas everywhere do best, and that is pull off the oil cap on the wheel. Please do not pull off the oil cap on the wheel. There's another one here now, Chandra. Two hyena. I can hear lions pulling away in the distance. Oops. Lifting the earpiece out, there we are. It's so cool. I don't think we can see them, but we can. Probably there's another one just about to climb in the window here on the right. Not sure if you can see it. There we are. Beautiful shot of the roof rack there. Unfortunately, Jean-André did try and take to that with an angle grinder, but the owner of the vehicle took offence, and so he was unable to cut it off. These hyenas can't believe what they've found. They've never seen a vehicle driving around here at this time of the day. I'm afraid I have no idea. Hello, Diane. You're wondering about whether or not the hyenas are here or as accustomed to vehicles as they are in the Sabi sand. Yes, I think they probably are. You know, they get viewed a huge amount, a huge number of tourists that come through here. They're just not allowed to drive around at night. I think one just could easily have tried to climb in the window there. There we are. Maybe my audio is a little bit dodgy. How's it now, Rebecca? I think it's because I've put a jersey on. There we go. So yes, they're absolutely as habituated, but they don't get viewed at night ever because the general populace, the average punter, as it were, is not privileged like you and I to be driving around here at night. No idea where they are, Chandra. Which side of the vehicle are they? Left side. Okay. There we are. And of course, if I was a pirate, I would say, just off the port stern. Eating something it's found. Delicious. Of course, I've brought a parrot to sit on my shoulder during the day, but they get hungry and they make a noise. Just getting to the edge of the infrared range now. And there, I believe we shall carry on and see if we can find the lion again. Very nice. Any more hyenas right in front of us? I can smell them, you know. Very strange smell. It's a very kind of sickly sweetish smell. It smells exactly like the den on Warbury's Road. All right, let's head across to Taylor while that hyena disappears into the darkness, find out what she has to show you, and we'll head towards the lions.
I actually
want to tell you, it is quite possibly a square-tailed nightjar. I'm looking at the picture now. They do occur here, slender-tailed. They do not occur here, so it's not... they might. It's almost impossible to tell everyone. Simply because, well, they're in IR, and unless they call, unless you get a really good colour view of them, it becomes totally impossible to tell what they are. But he's quite sweet, isn't he? He looks like a juvenile. I just say that because he's a bit scruffy looking, and we nearly ran him over. He was sitting completely silently on the road there. Now, the big thing about a nightjar like this, and I don't know if we definitely won't be able to see it tonight, because if he flies up, you see how quickly that happened. That's very cool. Let me tell you how that happens. They've got extremely broad wings, which means that one or two flaps throws them into the air very quickly. Is he back? I think he's back. There he is. So one or two flaps of those very broad wings tosses him up into the air very fast. He's not very good at sort of gliding, but he can gain speed very quickly. Now, how he does that, or the reason he does that, is because he picks up insects often in the air. I think he just picked one off the ground there. And if you look at most nightjars, their eyes are placed quite far to the top of the head, and they look and look right above them. And being able to flap straight up like that means that they can grab insects that are flying over the top of their heads. So they hide down, hunker down in some clearing like that, or in a little gully like the one he was in, and they flap once or twice and they shoot up into the air and grab the insect that's just flown over the top of him. Which I think is a rather clever strategy, and I don't know of any other bird that's able to do that, to be honest. Right, on we go. Now, let's quickly just show up there, Jean-Drew, if you wouldn't mind. There we are. Look at those lights there everywhere. That is where we are staying. It's quite possibly the finest establishment in the world. It's known as Angama Mara. And that is where our delicious packed dinners will be waiting for us when we return home. Yum, yum. Sorry, Jeffrey, I missed your question. We'll carry on driving while I answer it. Oh, Jeffrey, you want to know what birds we find here that we don't find at Juma? Jeffrey, there are quite a few. Certainly, I'm not experienced enough to list them all offhand, but obvious examples would include the Rupel's vulture, the purple grenadier, which is a very pleasant little sort of seed eater, the cordon bleu, which basically looks, well, there are various kinds of cordon bleu. They look like wax bills. And what else do we get here? Offhand. Many of the same sort of things, but in different numbers. So like an auger buzzard is quite a common bird here. And many more vultures that we get in the Sabi Sand, and that's because so much dies of natural causes. Great spotted eagle, which is quite interesting, and something called an imperial eagle, which I haven't yet seen. And I'd quite like to. Right, Taylor, I believe, has found yet another little nocturnal creature. Let's go and find out what it is. We've come back to the lions, everybody. They are astonishingly excited by their lives. You can see this female stuck her head up, her black-backed ears were glistening in the blackness of this night. And the lion, well, think he's alive. Yes, he is. He's breathing. Well done. Good for you, old fellow. There was a little bit of calling. Sorry, my audio is a bit muffled because my head is twisted looking. Is that better, Rebecca? Rebecca's on a 9-second delay, Shakes. She can only tell me 9 seconds after I tell her. Right, good. That sounds a bit better. So that's what the lions are doing. Nothing. We're going to wait and see if they call again, and then I think we're going to do another little sojourn around the place to see if there aren't some others. We did hear some calling further towards where that crossing was earlier, so it might be worth just popping down there, or certainly some of the way there, and see what happens. She's listening to something now. Let us too listen. Jean-André, what can you hear? I can't hear anything either. But she can. She's got good ears. Now, for those of you who have just joined us, we've just met these lions, which is a great joy, of course, to meet new lions. It's always nice to make a new friend. They are part of what we call the Kichwa Tembo Pride, which is made up of 6 lionesses, used to be made up of 7 cubs. 5 of them at least are dead. And Red, you wanted to know what the name of the pride was. Well, that's it, Kichwa Tembo. I'll tell you a little bit about that shortly. There's a rumor that there are 2 still alive, but everybody else seems to think that they're dead. I've heard one rumor. Now, that's because these 3 males, could be 4, have come into the area as new males. They've chased out the old chap called Scarface, as far as I know, and they are the Marsh Coalition males. So they have a really kind of deep attachment to that most famous of lion prides, the Marsh Pride from the Big Cat Diaries. So that's what's going on here. She's spotted something here. Ah, now Desiree has asked a very clever question, and I don't really know the answer, but I think I'm going to give you the answer that you'd quite like to hear. You want to know if, well, we all know that obviously when there's a coalition takeover like this, the new males come in and they kill the cubs, and that's obviously very unpleasant for us to watch, but you want to know if a lioness is pregnant when the coalition takeover takes place, will the new males still kill the cubs? And I think the answer is probably not, no. I think they would assume, presumably, if it didn't happen sort of a day after they arrived, I think that they would assume that those lioned cubs were theirs, especially if the females, or some of the females in the pride had come into anestrus or estrus and they had mated. Not even necessarily with the lioness who was pregnant. I think they'd be okay then. So she's heard something, and she killed a little wildebeest today. We managed to watch that astoundingly, and we just popped out of the camp and to go and sort of scout the landscape before we came live, and there she killed a little wildebeest, which was quite astounding to see. Now she can hear something else. So let's see what happens. Maybe a warthog is out for a midnight stroll. The thermal camera is pointing, I think, towards where she was looking. It might just be that she can hear lions calling way in the distance. Now, Red, Kichwa Tembo means, and I've got Simon here with me, so he can tell me if I'm talking rubbish. Kichwa, I think, is a head, correct?
Head of an elephant.
Is the head of an elephant. So Kichwa Tembo, head of the elephant. And there's a camp not too far from here called Kichwa Tembo. And I think it's after that camp that this lion pride is named. And because of that, it's also sometimes known as the Olulolo pride. And that is the gate and the escarpment on which our camp sits. I'm not sure. Does Olulolo have a name? Have a meaning? What does it mean? Okay, it means meandering. Okay, that's quite interesting. So like a winding river, Olulolo means winding. The escarpment. So that's what this pride has been known as well. We'll call them the Kichwa pride. That seems to be the general consensus in the area. One might also call them the recumbent pride, the sleepy pride at the moment, same as the Nkuhumas. You can see lions in East Africa and South Africa are the same. Okay, she's going to call. Well, that was very impressive indeed. She's looking towards where the other males are. That was very cool. Now, some people will tell you that they can hear the difference between a male and a female lion's call. I consider myself to be a person of very sensitive ears, and I can hear the difference between those two lions, but to be able to tell which one was male and which one was female, well, I think it'd be quite difficult. She's, I suppose, got a slightly higher pitched voice, but it's hardly a sort of ringing soprano to his deep voice. And that's them marking territory. They're just telling all the other lions in the area, this is our spot. I think she's also trying to make contact with the rest of the pride. And maybe they're calling. We did a long loop, everybody, round about where they were found this morning. Nothing so far. Let's just listen carefully. We're going to be quiet for 20 seconds and see if we can't hear something. Hear some way in the distance. That sounds like over the marsh, perhaps to the north. Well, that was great. They may well call again. The two other males are lying so flat on the road, their bottoms facing out, so they're really not looking in there at their best. They're not doing anything. So let's just sit here for a bit longer, and then we'll go for another sort of scanning of the area with the infrared torch. Not infrared, the, what's it called again? Thermal imaging torch. Just remember, this is coming to you from two amazing locations. Obviously, the iconic Kruger National Park in the south and the Mara Triangle up here in Kenya. Now, Taylor has seemed to have had a magnificent evening, especially after the new rains, finding lots and lots of little creepy, crawly things. Let's go and take a look at the latest edition.
I have no idea what type of ground beetle this one is. I've never seen it before. Look at its remarkable pattern, though, on its shoulder.
Everybody, this lion has lifted his head, he's yawned, he's looked into the night, and perhaps he's about to go stalking off into the darkness. Or maybe he'll go to sleep. Yes, his eyes are becoming heavy. Oh, shame. Oh. There we go. Ooh. Come on, give us a call. This is wonderful. Behind us are calling as well. You never get tired of that, everyone. And this female, I think, is in search of the rest of her pride. And they're so full, just in case you're wondering why they're not hunting, why they're not doing anything more effective than snooze, well, it's for exactly the same reason, of course, that the Nkuhuma pride isn't doing a great deal of hunting at the moment. It's simply because they've eaten so much over the last little while, especially in this area, that all of those wildebeests to devour, and so that's what they've been doing, and that's why they're hungry, and that's why they're not hungry. So I think our little plan is going to be to head away down towards the crossing point where we were earlier, and we might be very lucky to find something fascinating there. Well, I'm pretty sure we will, but we'll shine the thermal camera into the darkness and see what we can find. I'm hoping, you know, the only two times I've ever seen an aardvark were well after 10 o'clock at night. We've just hit 10 o'clock local time here. Maybe we'll find a Kenyan aardvark as we go. Right, here we go. One last look at the lions. There they are. And on we go. Hello, Andy and Julia in Los Angeles. You want to see, know if lions see differently, I think I heard you correctly, lions see differently during the night and during the day. Well, they don't see differently in so much as their eyes don't change at all, but I mean, exactly like you suggest, similarly to us, they see different shades because there's no light, and because they have a different ratio of what we call rods to cones in their eyes, it's a little bit more, what did I want to say? They can see a far greater sort of contrast, difference between light and dark, but they can't see the same depth of color that we can. And that's the sacrifice you make for being able to see at night. Where do you want to go? Sorry, I'm just talking to Simon, everyone. We're just going to do a loop. Do you want to go back?
No, I don't know where. We're still doing that.
Yeah. Sorry, we can have a question again from Justin S. I was just talking to Simon there. You want to know how much colour, if any, a lion can see. Well, apparently lions see in sort of shades of red, green and blue. And so it's pretty much, I think it's pretty monochrome other than that. They don't see any kind of yellows and oranges and reds and that sort of thing. And so it's very much the same for us, seeing in black and white. But they don't see black and white, and that's key. Because, of course, many of their prey, for example, something like an impala or a nyala, or in this case out here, an eland or that sort of thing, well, they're just obviously red-coloured, and to us they're pretty easy to see, but to the lions, they disappear in amongst the greens and blues. Now, this is a fairly main road. It runs parallel with the Mara River, and we'll turn towards the river shortly and see if we can't find something there. I know there's a road I want to take to the left, it loops back towards the river. Right, let's get the thermal camera out there. Graham, what have you spotted? apparently something off to the left, nothing particularly entertaining. Otherwise, nothing, but if we do see something, we shall be sure to tell you about it, no doubt. All right, Jamie is back with some lions. I hope, I don't know if it's the same ones. If she's finished her border patrol, with any luck, it's a new one. So let's go and find out. We're in Juma, and two-thirds in the United Kingdom, and two-thirds everywhere else, if I'm not mistaken, today. We are still in the Southern Hemisphere, in case you're wondering about the orientation. Sorry about my audio, everybody. It will be the same orientation here as it is back at Juma. Now, we've stopped here next to our male lion because he has lifted his head up. This is the other brother. Now, I don't know for certain, you know, what their names are yet. We're just getting to grips with that. But if you look at this chap, there we are. There is a lion called Scar in this coalition, apparently. That could be him. If that's not the same as Scarface, who that is inescapably not. He does have quite a few scars on his face. And just to reiterate, everyone, these lions not moving around for exactly the same reason as the Nkuhumas aren't. They've just eaten too much. They're just like you are after a heavy Sunday lunch. Good night. Hello, Robin D. Very good question from you about how a coalition knows where its boundaries are when they take over an area. Robin, I think it's largely from the smell of other lions. Just up ahead, John. Oh, you got him. And what they do is they smell other lions, and that becomes the boundary. So if you take over a territory, this guy looks a bit stiff. He's just having a stretch. Take over a territory, and they will be bounded by other lions. It's very seldom that, you know, an area is completely devoid of lions. And that's how the territory will stay. But, of course, that can shift. So if that coalition that is on, say, the southern boundary of a lion's territory passes on, then they will probably expand because they cannot smell those old lions around the place. So I think it's largely based on how, you know, the other lions that they smell in the area and how confident they feel about challenging those other lions. I think it probably also has to do with the female territories, because very seldom, in fact, I can't think of an instance where a male's territory will encompass a female's and then half of another one, or half of an adjacent female pride's territory. In fact, that's probably more likely to be almost the answer in its entirety. So we know the Birmingham boys dominate two prides, the Sticks and the Nkuhumas, and their territory quite neatly fits over the two of them. Now, it's probably slightly bigger, but I don't think they have half another pride's territory. Shall we have a look at the thermal? John, this is quite a nice thermal image, if you like. I didn't mean to sort of tell you what to do. Sandy, sorry, my Skype call broke up as your question came through. I think it was, are these boys the same size as the Birmingham boys? Was that correct? Oh, you say they seem to have much thicker front legs than the Birminghams. Sandy, no, I don't think they have thicker front legs. I think what you're noticing is that they are fuller built. They're really kind of right at the almost the sort of optimum weight that they'll get to, somewhere between 7 and 8 years old. And I think these guys, the very blonde one looked to be about 6 to me, but maybe a bit older. Some of them probably about 7. So they're almost at their full weight, which means that they will be stockier than the Birminghams. I don't think they're any taller. They may be slightly taller, but not much. Their manes will be definitely fuller, and they just will be heavier than the Birminghams are at the moment. But the Birminghams, I don't think they're very big lions. In fact, I think they're on the smallish side. But they'll get to about this size when they're 7 or 8 years old. Righty, let's carry on along the road. We might be lucky to find a few more creatures of the Kenyan night. Well, hang on a second. Let's just wait and see if he doesn't call. See if he's got a very beautiful voice like his brother's. I've never met a lion with a poor voice, you know, Jean-André. Right, let's leave him to luxuriate in the tickling of the red oat grass. On we go. Jen Ward, you want to know if I've got my blankie? I do not have my blankie. I've got another blankie. There we are. It's actually a seat cover, Jen. This entire car is covered in a rather bizarre green tartan, which we have yet to find the origins of. And I've got the seat cover from my seat over my little exposed leggies. Thank you for your concern. Ooh. Ah, we stopped just in time. That was absolutely hopeless timing. All right, everybody, let's go over to, I think it's Taylor. Is it Taylor we're going to? We're going on there. A hippopotamus standing beneath a fascinating tree called Balanites aegyptica. And I think that's called a desert date in English. Now, of course, many of you will know of the Balanites tree on Juma. That's Balanites magami, the torchwood. And that tree that we've just seen there is one of the most iconic trees of this particular part of the world. Dotted across the clearings. This is a wonderful hippo sighting. We thought this hippo would move off. Many of them have moved off away from us. But this one is feeding, sort of, and then listening every time I exclaim its magnificence. That's fantastic. Look at that. Now, you cannot believe that those great big chomping teeth have any usefulness to a grazing animal. And they don't really, except when they're defending their territory. Or their babies from crocodile attack, perhaps. But that hippo is now slightly suspicious of it. What it feels is probably a slight tingling in the eye. But you can't really see what it is that's doing that. And they've hardly got incisor teeth. It's basically their lips that they use to pick those great big swathes of grass. That's very cool. And I'm just going to quickly send a message to the final control via you that I cannot hear them at all. I'm going to close down the call and try and redo it. Amazing. That hippo got no idea. Yeah, I'm afraid I've lost the final control completely, so I can't talk to Rebecca. I'll try and WhatsApp Jerry. of course, the point of my telling you all of this, everybody, is so that they can actually hear me. There we go. Where we've got Jerry back. Hello, Jerry. Now, what's interesting, are we still alive, Rebecca? Oh, we're still alive. That's wonderful. Now, an hippopotamus, unlike its rather large equivalent, the white rhinoceros, doesn't eat nearly as much food. Apparently, almost half to two-thirds of what you'd expect for an animal like this. So a hippo, at least a big white rhino, will eat about 40 kilograms of this kind of grass a day. And a hippopotamus, well, I've read things as small as 8 kilos. And it might be up to sort of 20, but it's definitely far less than a rhino. And I think that's because they don't do anything in the day. They just lie in the water, wallowing about the place. They don't actually have to hold their whole mass. Oh, geez, we have an amazing time with the bush babies at Juma. There's another one now with Jamie.
Hey, one of my favorite nocturnal animals to look at, a little bush baby who's been giving us the most incredible demonstration of its jumping skills, hasn't it, Dave? We've been chasing it back.
All right, everybody, that's going to be it from us here in the Mara Triangle, as well as the Sabi Sunt down in sunny South Africa. It's been a real joy to bring this to you, and I'm really looking forward to the next 4 nights or so. Hopefully those lions will get off their bottoms and do something useful. I'm sure the Nkuhumas will as well. A big thank you to Jandre. Thank you, Jandre, for your efforts. A big thank you to Rebecca and Jerry and Louise in the final control with Alex, the Russian, who apparently looked miserable from beginning to end, but that's pretty normal. And a big thanks to Graham and Emily, they're here, and to Jamie and Taylor and the big cameraman team down on the ground there in Johannesburg. We will see you tomorrow in the afternoon, 3 o'clock this side? 4 o'clock. 4 o'clock this side, 3 o'clock that side. A little bit tired. We'll see you then. Thanks for joining us. Bye-bye.